logics and later back in the University of Leuven, some of our graduate students worked on a thesis using some of this work. I will now hand off the microphone to Bruno de Boeri, who will talk about the Belgian context.
So from Vietnam to Belgium, from tropical conditions to modern conditions, from conditions like in the Mekong, where domestication of the landscape is relatively recent, this from something in the last two, three centuries, and surely the urbanization is a very, very recent phenomenon, at least the scale is happening, to a region like the one here, Urbanhart, in southwest Flanders, in Belgium, that has been domesticated since centuries. And where actually, as you see on the map, this is an 18th century map, almost all nature already has disappeared because everything is used to be terrible. Leading to landscapes like that, leading from time to time to homeopathic processes of nature are still a fruit tree standing. So, in our context, in the Belgian context, it's much more about the necessity to reintroduce the territory by nature, to reintroduce nature, to cut a step back from the over-exploitative use of the landscape, or this over-exploitative attitude to the territory, to come to a much more defined balance, which is doing basically, has to do basically in our case, if we do it first urbanism, or we try to do it as first urbanism approaches, is two things simultaneously. It is to restore ecologies and forests as a kind of metaphor, but also as a reality, as a kind of multiple space of natural environments, as one of the key instruments to that. So it is to weave in, intertwine again a very strong piece of nature to create ecology, to recreate nature, but simultaneously by doing that, improving the urban. Because the urban has been overwhelming the whole territory and over exploiting the territory, and by that in a certain way killed all the qualities of it. So this is a kind of a schematic example of how we do this for the city of Kirchberg, the highway, requalifying infrastructure, getting out infrastructure, reforesting, and creating a natural system. Not just functional things, but chains of elements that start functioning as a system. This is a plan for the urban forest of Marke, which would be the city forest of Kortrijk, as all central cities in Belgium are by decree obliged to build the urban forests. What we did there is a kind of a frontal line between 32 and 38 meters, which was in the 19th century, 20th century, kind of the clay extraction line, where they took the clay for the brick industry, which is kind of a distorted landscape nowadays, to use this kind of distorted over-exploited landscape to reintroduce as a brownfield from clay extraction a new forest as a kind of a crown on the landscape systems simultaneously, create a kind of a structure that goes beyond the city itself. That would look this like that, and all of a sudden the property becomes the center of the reorganized territory with different patches of forest and different patches of urban forestry that are introduced, that not only structure the natural environment, but simultaneously create a new frame for the urban to restructure itself. And the detailed exercise for the parkway, which is the south side of the highway, which is the area actually in which all the suburban sprawl has occurred in the afterwar period, where you have the university, where you have the business park, where you have the hospital, where you have the colleges and the school, which all have fled the city in kind of patchwork or the institutions, and that ran out of the reserve of terrain, forest urbanism, and water urbanism plan for the restructuring of the business park site of the city of Antwerp. That one builds a new ecology, and simultaneously builds a new frame for the further urban development of the city. By that, improving it by a systematic afforestation program with different types of trees, different types of environments, and different conditions for different patches that are addressed second side I would like to explore in this small presentation is something we try to start up in Zonian Forest. Some of you might know Zonian Forest is an 18th century reconstructed gigantic forest to the south of Brussels. It's the largest forest in Belgium. And it's for many it's actually considered as the recreation park of the city. Historical depicturing reminded us that forests are in the lowlands, in the Belgian lowlands, actually very historical figures. They have been had a very long history on multiple spaces, the places of mobility, is also the places of poaching, the places of harvesting timber, the places of recreation, the places where we used to keep our ancestors sometimes. Besides the romanticism about the deep history and the multiple histories of the Southern Forest, what it has to face nowadays. It is next to the capital of Europe, Brussels has considered itself as its capital, the enormous development pressure for the city, functioning as the park of the city, and by that becoming ecologically in a very strong stress. It has a lot of mobility challenges around it, but the forest also has been used, abused to provide main infrastructures as the highway ring roads around Brussels. So major challenges with infrastructure. Major challenges of big urbanization, just very urbanization, suburbanization that systematically has been eating in the last 150 years, which is a territory that actually the suburban territory, which is when you look at the highest of growth, is also a form of urban forestry, but not recognized as such, but simultaneously a relatively poor form of urban forestry. It should be strengthened and should also simultaneously deal with the transformation of suburban urban environments into more intense urban environments that are appropriate. And of course, there's all the challenges of ecology that, in relation to a big metropolitan European scale of 1 million inhabitants, is occurring. So we worked on this since the line. We're just initiating the process of building, actually rebuilding the Zonian Forest into a larger national park system that will connect the Hauerbos, the Zonian Forest, and Meulder, so three forests will be reconnected over this suburban sprawl that we have seen, in which we would try to use instruments as pooling of properties as a way to get a larger patches within the territory that could be transformed, pooling and transfer of development rights so that some pieces become much more urban and some pieces of this suburban environment could be renaturalized or reforested. The existing situation is also in the west corner. The city of Brussels anchored on the Zanne and the forest actually being the interfluvium, the origin between the two river valleys that you see in the picture. An orange urbanization that has encroached on the forest that is almost strangling the remainders of the forest that has lost big pieces in the 19th and 20th century. But you also see in the south and to the east a kind of intertwining of relics of forests and creeping in of urban forests. So there's a very intense interplay between the city and the forest from its origins. There's a city in the valley and the forest on the plateau, and mutual relationships that they had to a kind of intertwined developments that had its ideas in the post-war periods. The existing mobility nets make a lot of abuse of the forest. So one of the thinking lines is to decommission infrastructures within the forest, to understand that the forest is not to be something with a high cutting through, that the forest as a big ecological reserve could also be a kind of stepstone that you have to go around, and that when you go to the forest, it's still getting lost in eventually as you would go as a man, and not simply to use it as a crossroads that then spells out in the ecological structure. So parts of the study are about that. But then of course it's also understanding of settlements, cities, and villages alike being featured in the water system, with some pilgrimage places on the hilltops, on the ridges between the Leire Valley and the Zenne Valley, forms of agro-urbanism when parts of the forest were domesticated for agricultural purposes, and then the urban that creeps in at certain moments. With urban development along infrastructures, since the 20th century, with marvelous garden cities and pieces of forest settlement that nestled themselves within the natural structure, and residential landscapes that fall a little between the urban forestry and the residential landscape, but also many developments that you simply would call voluntary urbans that make abuse of the natural resources that are at hand. So the idea was to reverse this evolution of simply encroaching on nature, to shift dormitory settlements away with the tools that we have been explaining of transfer of development rights and pooling of properties. So settlements which have very large connections, which are on prime agricultural land or on prime fertile lands and prime wetlands, to take them out, to organize a transition, to renaturalize them, and to focus on places where they would be better located, and organize a transformation, a transition process of much more introduction of urban forestry within urban environments that would go hand in hand with the restoration of ecologies from an existing ecological system, which is the relic forest in the dark green and all the light green, which is urban forestry around it, and to start seeing through the region that is managing this forest, that is not only about this forest, but also basically work all the urban forestry elements around them, and to strengthen those, to build a much more robust system that is using the water system and the ridge lines to build new ecological systems across the plateau that go from valley to valley, and that we start organizing a new frame in which a new form of urbanization could take place, or better, in which a transition from the existing urban towards a new form of urban could be organized in interrelationship. Developing all types of instruments for this on the small scale, which has to do with transformation of the rhythm developments, and then testing this in a number of sites, like in the most known site that we tested, which is of how this ecological system could be re-penetrating the city with historical park systems as they exist, but also, for example, to the north, that you see in the north, is this green-blue finger, which is a decommissioning of a highway that penetrates the city into a natural system that is restoring natural water systems and ecological systems. And by that, penetrating within the city and recreating a new frame for the urban development in this part of the city. In the south, similar exercise at the south border of the forest, of working with the existing domains, but also building stepstones, with more ecological stepstones between this big domains and the salt red domain and the IBM domain that encroach on the forest, to restore the larger scale forest system that simultaneously could absorb pieces of the new urban. The last part is the previous great site area of Brussels, Soulax, in which basically one three big patches of reforestation are developed. One in the transformation, as you can see, in the pastoration system of an agricultural greenhouse system that is transformed in the patchwork of new urban agriculture, new urban forestry mixed with housing, the restoration of an arm of the forest, and to the east, one of this dormitory urbanism parks in which that organized the fading out of the urban and the reintroduction of the forest. By that, creating three branches of the forest that, as corridor systems, reconnect the forest, on the important tributaries of the lake. Testing how this could be in the different conditions of how it is nowadays, and how in this afforestation on the homeopathic dose are the more important causes of the transformation of the suburban environment of private gardens could become much more a collective afforested new even to develop in the future.
Dynamic just seen this image for a moment. I was just speaking in San Francisco on an event that was associated to climate action conference, and I met Nemonte, who is here on the right. And apparently Nemonte is a native to the Western Amazon, and she was presenting her cause, her existential, in its existential controversy, that, you know, is threatening her life, not only her personal life, but, you know, what is being threatened is actually the mode of existence. And I would like you to remind this notion of mode of existence for a little bit. So, I don't know if you can read this right here on the top, which is quoting her, talking about that, you know, she was coming here and she doesn't feel strange in the West because we are connected. That's her words, right? And she continues saying, well, because the forest connects us. So I feel we need to investigate a little bit into that, because I feel there is a very important message in her way of understanding her being on that planet, you know, in regard to what our steps are going to be in the next years to come. When I show those images, please don't get me wrong, I'm not arguing for an idealized past or, you know, some other place. It's about, again, it's about the mode of existence of the indigenous, how they understand their embeddedness on the planet. And you understand this, of course, when we go to this image that shows a clear cut. That is a clear cut in the Brazilian Amazon region. It's the Cerrado landscape right here. You see the dimensions. This is for soy plantations, which is being sold to Europe, to Italy, to Germany, but also to Asia, to, you know, feed the animals with soy. So that is our mode of existence, right? The modern mode, our modernity, you know, apparently has consequences in a different part of the planet in a massive way. And when you just recall the little squares you just saw on the world map, you know, those changes that are so abstract have actual, real, you know, incidences, as you can see it here in the landscape. So while these maps are so incredibly abstract, they actually have, of course, an underlying reason for the specific locality of these red squares, which indicate, of course, changing climates and temperatures. I think this controversy that Nemonte was presenting at in San Francisco, again, I think traces, you know, its origin to our mode of existence, which is the modernity. And modernity is doing something that, you know, we should be very aware of, and that's why I'm leaving this so much space here for you guys, because I think it's really our mode of thinking that in the end, you know, allows us to divert from this current path that we are going still along in a way to separate our cultural endeavors from the non-human natural. And you can see with that slide, of course, you know, the separation that whatever we consume here is so far off. It's Brazil, right? I mean, I can't even see it and imagine it. You know, this distance creates separation, of course, which is very convenient for us, including me, right, in our way of habitation in the Western world, which feels so comfortable, of course. I'd like to ask Bruno Latour right here. You know him as a very outspoken, you know, thinker these days, you know, to help me out with this. And, you know, of course, he has, for quite some time, he has recognized the separation of the non-human world and our human world, and the idea that, you know, we are cultural. culture and out there is nature. And I have to tell you that, you know, this the use of the notion of nature creates problems, and I'll be getting into that in a moment. So he associates the separation, the, you know, dialectics of culture and nature with our understanding of modernity. Modernity was very successful in creating separate entities, even in the academics, right? Academic fields are separate entities that are very successful in, you know, developing knowledge into the depth, but, you know, some at some point, you know, not recognizing, you know, the deep connections. So this book I can highly recommend because it's really witty, and he's making that comment on the title when he says, okay, we have never been born yet. So what does he mean with that? That's a graphic from Bruno Latour, and you see on the top the dichotomy of the non-human nature to the left and the human culture on the right. And the separation is really causing us to believe in our human culture that whatever we do, right, you know, it's not really having consequences. We are not articulate enough to understand that in our language that, you know, separating nature is causing consequences on nature, but are invisible, which is the second dichotomy. You see the hybrid networks that is actually representing that what he claims to be real, which is messy. Our world is messy because we, you know, of course, have consequences on whatever we do on our planetary reality. So why did I introduce Nemonte today? Because I think she gives this missing piece, at least for our team, to understand from where we are arguing out and where our thinking should emerge. The thing is, Nemonte is not having a notion for nature. So in her life, in her mode of existence, nature does not exist. That's crazy, isn't it? So it's all based on the idea of culture. And of course, you know, animism, so there is the idea that there is life and soul in everything. And that helps a lot to understand how they, in their culture, you know, negotiate with the forest, with life as such, understanding that there is no separated entity where you can kind of reclaim from and become culture on another side. But that's what we did, of course, and that, you know, this city that you can see here going up almost is an icon for the separation of culture and nature. You see the idea, the icon of culture as a city here in the center, separated from its surrounding. There is absolute, you know, no understanding how to negotiate, you know, even climate or the environment, or, you know, you can see artist Carrie Young here kind of contemplating on the trash, on that one, what we in modernity apparently seem to understand as the outside of culture, even, you know, out far enough outside to even just put the trash over there. So the question is, okay, is there a need still for this separation, for the separating culture from nature? Or, you know, how would we be able to move beyond this understanding as we are immersed in modernity, right? I mean, we use those notions just every single day, and it's really hard to change our thinking in that mode. So I would like to suggest that, you know, we start with thinking across scales, for instance, right? So as our beautiful colleagues just did, right? So it's a lot about, you know, making the point that our existence, our habits, you know, have huge consequences in the landscape, on the land. So it's really important, I think, you know, to connect the scales of the world with our actual practice, which is on eye level, which is us, our doing. And I think this is a very important moment to start off from. So making that connections, I would like to introduce the idea of the city as a living entity. The city as something that is connected to the idea that Nemonte maybe is living, right? It's a living of the natural, and I'm still using that terminology myself, as you can hear. You know, the living environment is something you think from within. You know, it's not something that is separate, that you work on it with the modern tools on the natural sphere, but to go into that mode of existence to work it from within. So we're moving slowly to this site that, just looking for the pointer, it's somewhere here. Because there's a site, this is apparently not the entire site we're working on, but it's right here. It's a city called Palmas in Tocantins, which is the capital of the state of Tocantins. And between these, this black biome, which is the Amazon, and the bluish one, which is the Cerrado biome, it's right here, Palmas, at the edge of not only of two biomes, but also between, I would say, between a highly already developed cultivated landscape, soy, etc., is being cultivated here immensely, and you know something that we consider still as a unit, the Amazon, that seems to be outside of our modern condition of being. We're looking at a city which is here. It's unfortunately, we can barely see it. Please think of a second pixel in between every pixel here on the screen. But that's the city along this artificial lake that was initiated only in 1998. And I would like to, with you, to explore the condition of Palmas a little bit. As it is, I think, a great example to understand what modernity means and you know what we can make out of modern cities as we are not just you know developing new cities on our planet. This is Brasilia, as you know, very iconic master plan by Lucio Costa, Oscar Niemeyer, and of course Roberto Marx as the landscape architect. And this is Palmas in Tocantins, and they're in the same scale. So we're talking about a city that is massive, and I'm not saying that because I would be proud of it, but that it's so massive that it creates massive problems. The quad right here in Brasilia, the small unit has 560 meter by 560 meter. The quad in Palmas has 800 by 800 meters, and was designed by Grupo Quattro in 1998. So the city is an incredibly young city, founded in 1998. To understand where you know this, as those cities apparently follow a similar logic of modernity, where that comes from, and that's a sketch by Oscar for Brasilia, and you see you know the Euclidean grid basically that is somehow juxtaposed to the undulating landscape over there. So the separation, right, from the cultural, the logical, the rational to the natural is of course still visible here in that sketch. So it's definitely a very modern and modernistic approach that of course you can also find here in Palmas, in Tocantins, a city that has already grown to that extent. So you see this aerial view, and you see the grids and you know the beginning of the urbanization of those green grids, the central axis right over here. So this condition again of expansiveness was tackling a lot of thinking in our team. How can we approach a city and you know give some positive advice as we have been commissioned on projects But because it was recently basically referenced, somehow locate the idea of landscape as urbanism in early modernity by Charles Wolfheim. So I felt like, okay, we need to go back to understand this condition of this expansiveness of urban systems in looking at those maps. And what I find really important to distinguish when you look at those drawings, it's less looking at the grid, but looking at what the landscape is doing in this urban scheme. And for me, thinking about the dichotomy that we were just referencing between culture and nature, the nature, here is definitely assigned a very passive role in this design. And I think this is exactly the condition in modernity that nature is being rendered passive, and culture, of course, as active, as setting the tone, the dimensions, the grid, the proportions. So in a city, Palmas, that of course references this design, as you just could see, how could we move into an understanding of a future that goes beyond that, assigns not only another nature, a modern nature onto the city in just planting vegetation, but imagine a city where the forest performs, becomes active, becomes social, becomes ecological in a very active way. So again, as this city is so massive, and Milan, in reference, has about 182 square kilometers, like in a city lines, Palmas has 1,000 square kilometers in its extent. So how would we even address the idea of urban forest performance in a city like that? But it's almost like a paradox. It's exactly what we found, finally, that this unprecedented expansiveness became our tool to addressing a possible future of Palmas, and then we're closing two projects that we are working on. One is this year on the top, one of the smaller quadras, and this urban landscape that we have been designing over here. It's the idea that that we address and assign a field condition to the entire city. So instead of working on patches with vegetation in between the urban realm, we felt like, okay, what if we think that city as such, as a forest, as such? No distinction anymore between the city and the forest, but how can we introduce the overlay of these two seemingly separate entities into the future? We started with field conditioning the larger park area that you have just been seeing through mapping those changes in time, starting with planting places where the future of the park itself could actually grow in plantations, and from there, in the future, the entire landscape can be supplied with vegetation and trees as the city is growing and as further functions are moving in. So there is a continuous implementation not only of public programs but also of vegetations, of forest patches, of also permaculture forests that provide, for instance, climatic benefits to the city as it is unfolding. Can you see this at all in the back? I'm not sure, but so just imagine this is a large park of 660 hectares with social public infrastructure all along this big lake over here. But what we introduce, and this is very important for the further unfolding of the city, are those patches over here that follow drainage patterns that we introduced newly into the grid, disturbing the grids of the city to allow also microclimates to unfold, to allow the topography again to regain its validity in the development of the city. This is really hard to read, but you know, these are very different, let's say, forest plant communities that we introduce, all native, of course, related to the Cerrado on the one side and to the more rainforest biomes on the other side, where there is more wet vegetation in those drainage patterns. So while we were developing those different plant communities, we very importantly we have been assigning a social practice to these different plantations. That means we were planting a harvesting landscape. And not going deeper into that project, I would love to kind of dive into the quadra itself that we are currently after receiving some additional funding from the World Bank, are going to further develop. So this idea of a living biome, the city as a living biome, of course includes people, right? And the vegetation that we would like to introduce, be understood not only as beautiful, as delivering ecosystem services, but also as something that relates in a high degree to social practice. We strongly believe that, we're relating social practice to those forests. Not only educates the people, but allow them to, foster a very different and much more intimate relationship with their environment. So, looking at one of those quadras that we are working on right now, this is in the north of the city, we were thinking of basically founding this idea of that neighborhood on the idea of a permaculture forest, a living, cultivated forest that is there to be harvested, that is providing not only like services, but in itself has an existence, has even a spirituality you could assign that to as well. Something that is just much more than a forest next to urban habitation, but really overlaying this idea of the forest with an urban future, with the idea of urban design and architecture. Yeah. Very quickly, starting with climate, just going back to our Austrian pavilion. So the idea of climate as something that we can, of course, assign as a tool for our urban future seems to be very important, because climate is something that is not just occurring, but as you may have experienced it in Milan, you can design it, right? You can use those tools that the living, our living reality is providing us, which is microclimates that are very easy and wonderful to experience when you can test it, as we have had the possibility here in the pavilion itself. And to understand that these ideas can be applied, of course, in larger contexts as we are about to design here in the quadra of Palmas. So, as you can somehow sense it here, this permaculture forest, of course, relates to the topologies of habitation that we are proposing. So it's not that architecture is first and then the forest is later, but it's a constant exchange, it's a constant negotiation with the functional aspects of housing, of social housing, and the functionality, so to say, of a living permaculture forest. And then all in that context, where you may not be able to read it here, but this reads 65 degrees, on the ground versus just beneath the trees, 34 degrees. So that's just amazing what vegetation is able to, you know, change in terms of supplying a habitable climate. The same in the Austrian pavilion with a little support. So this is a system that I think we, you know, strongly need to introduce to our urban system. So we started with an initial simulation of the climate performance of the forest itself, not going too much into detail here right now, but understanding that, you know, of course the forest needs a certain density, the forest needs a certain presence to really perform as a forest, not being passive as a beautiful green that can be harvested, but to be understood as a forest, you know, with those entities that work on the ecological, biological, and on the climate aspect. And as we know, you know, this is not something that can be separated then anymore you know, from us. You know, when we immerse in those environments, they are alive, they are biotic. They inform eventually even also our microbiome. As for instance, depression is associated with, you know, dysfunctional microbiomes in larger cities. You know, microbiomes become, I think, a very important aspect in healthy cities of the future. So I'm almost done showing to you two or three more slides about, you know, what kind of community of agents, of protagonists are we looking at, and these are many. So we are looking at negotiating with many entities of, you know, city officials, of course, the ecologists, you know, community groups, etc., you know, to make that, you know, entity between a living forest and a habitable neighborhood reality. Very importantly, I think this is really also about providing people to, you know, to live their lives, even their, you know, base their economic being in the world on that forest. So the idea of developing microeconomies in the forest is a major issue. Also relying on the local knowledge, reintroducing the local knowledge to then allow somebody even, you know, to have you know, a little economic, you know, project like this to make their lives. So this is my final slide for today. That I would love you to recognize, you know, that again, think the disciplines that we so much, you know, we're basing our, I think, approaches for the modern city on are somehow dissolving in this kind of thinking. Yes, we call it urban design, architecture, or landscape, or ecology, or forestry, but I think it's really time to understand that beyond, going beyond these, you know, disciplinary separation, that's where the future is. And I would really invite you, you know, to become activists of that area, to go beyond disciplinary boundaries and to be the one that are really connecting all the different, you know, strains to make those inhabitable futures possible. Thank you.
Engaged without forcing them into a design system.
living social systems, but they have to immerse in those systems. So our work is based on being on site, working with community groups, working not only with the planning department, which again looks from the top, right, but you know, really trying to approach those projects from the island, from you to me.
I appreciate your presentation as well very much, thank you. From your presentation about this dichotomy about culture and nature, I got stuck with one of your first slides that it distinguished between productive and non-productive landscapes. And I was wondering if you could explain it a little bit further why you do this distinction. Thank you.
Perspective to three-dimensional perspective. So square meters and hectares were exchanged. So thank you for the whole presentation, especially for the second one, because I'm from Brazil, so it means a lot of working there, working ideas for my country. But I want to ask, could be for all of you, just to comprehend the limits of the ideas that we always have in this field of the environmental approach to the urban questions. Because, for example, from my background, from Brazil, looking for example, to the proposals that try to orient the growth of the cities and trying to protect some areas, and or also provide reforestations for some areas. When we provide infrastructure to orient the growth of the city, sooner or later, the city, the economical speculation of lands, sooner or later it take part.
Sooner or later, these other interests, they take part also of the protected areas. And another approach, like to provide a green neighborhood or an eco neighborhood for the cities, in my country, at least in my country, with what we see most part of the time, that these parts transform itself like in a place to a high profile, economical high profile places. So they're just a point that doesn't get in all the situations of the city. They are isolated from the other parts as some paradisiac island in the city for the people who have money to, for example, to pay for this quality that you presented, that I think that would be really nice to see it built in the place that you are working, that is today a really dry place and place of these soil fields. And I want to ask, if it's possible to conciliate all the antagonist interests that we have in the political field, or it's a mistake to try to conciliate, because some of them, they are, it's impossible to conciliate. That is my question.
That is quite a question, right? So I think we need to answer this as a group. But let me start with this. So first of all, we're not designing for which neighborhood social housing, which I think is important to make that point that this is not a quality that is only assigned to people who can afford it. This should